गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल दी ग्रुप मेंबर्स एंड माय कलीग्स एंड माय टीचर्स। तो टुडेज प्रेजेंटेशन इज जस्ट अ बर्ड्स आई व्यू ऑन हाउ आई हैव अंडरस्टूड ऑप्थैल्मोलॉजिकल डिजीजेस एंड हैव ट्रीटेड इन माय एक्सपीरियंस। सो आई वुड बी जस्ट शेयरिंग माय एक्सपीरियंस। आई एम ऑलवेज रेडी टू लर्न फ्रॉम ऑल माय टीचर्स अराउंड। So it's bird's eye view on ophthalmological disorders and diseases and its treatment with homeopathy. When I begin my career, I always knew that eye is the smallest organ of the body. But over a period of time, I realized it's difficult to treat because it is difficult to convince patients that, you know, homeopathy can help you. The belief system is so much less by the patients that, you know, homeopathy can treat the eye diseases, because they feel that anything related to eye is an emergency condition. It's a do or die situation. And because there is always a threat to lose the eyesight, and it has to be treated on an urgent basis. And the only treatment available is the modern medicine or the ophthalmic surgeons. So this is a concept which I had actually perceived from the patients all over when I started learning ophthal and started treating it. So it's a very uncommon journey for a person who's a common budding homeopath. There was a lack of complete model or protocols. So when we talk about models or protocols, I have seen that, you know, if a patient is suffering from allergic eye disorder, so there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 steps which should be done and followed. And then, you know, the allergy of the eye can be taken care of from the modern medicine side. If suppose a person lands up with a vitreous hemorrhage, there has to be 1, 2, 3, 4 steps which has to be taken and the patient will be taken care of. So there was no complete model or protocol. Neither I could find many homeopathic doctors who were giving medicines for ophthalmic disorders. So this was what was the situation. There was no observational experience which I could get, especially in Mumbai and Maharashtra area. Faced a lot of discouragement when I went to ophthalmic surgeons to learn. They said that you learn a basic and then you refer the patients to us. There is no need for you to go in detail because it's a surgical branch. So as it is, as a physician, you need not know so much in detail. So that was a feedback which was given. And so that's why I learned ophthalmology as a subject after working at government hospitals, just by assisting them, by, you know, being a junior to them and, you know, just observing them or just a volunteer in the camps, ophthalmic camps. So first thing which I learned is that, you know, if you want to know ophthalmology as a clinical subject, we need to know certain basic instruments to operate, like you should know slit lamp examination, you should know what is ophthalmoscopic, direct ophthalmoscopic examination, indirect ophthalmoscopic examination, and you have to do a keratometry and all these things I was learning and learned over a period of time. And that was really helpful in the diagnosis, because there are certain conditions of the eye which can be seen through naked eye and from the subjective experience of the patient. But there are a lot of objective clinical findings or objective things which can be assessed only after you learn these instruments and do a clinical thorough examination. So that's why learning them was very important. So these are the instruments, diagnostic instruments. This is a slit lamp for the examination. You can easily see corneal related problems and conjunctival issues and the anterior chamber and the iris and the lenticular portion. You can see with the slit lamp. This is an auto refractometer, and this is for doing a A scan and all to see what is the lens number when you are operating a patient for the cataract surgery, especially in the cases where there is a mature cataract. We need to remove it. So these are the certain things which we need to learn. So it was around 15-16 years of journey from a student hood to a RMO and medical officer consultant, then a full-fledged consultant. So I'm just sharing my learning experience in different roles and capacities, and thankful to my institutes who have helped me to learn from the patients because they were visiting their OPDs. So I was just learning, assisting there or becoming a medical officer and a consultant there. So as I've already mentioned, eye appears to be a small organ, but its affections can be detrimental. Eye can be affected or involved because of various etiologies or causes. So etiology becomes a very important thing, as it is, we have seen it in homeopathy. Causation is a very important thing, whether it is infective origin, whether it is an allergic origin, whether it is inflammatory autoimmune origin, whether it is because of the trauma or the injuries, and whether it is a congenital issues. So these are the categories under which we often classify nosocomial classification of the ophthalmic disorders. Similarly, this classification also helps us to understand from a homeopathic angle. You know, we get some of the important relevant modalities which can be utilized for homeopathic totality construction. Different parts of the eye has a different type of symptomatology or presentation. So every part of the eye will present in a different manner. Like example, when a patient gets pain, lacrimation and redness, so you feel that it is conjunctivitis. But if it is associated with severe photophobia, that means sensitivity to light, so it is much more than conjunctivitis. So then here it can be a corneal involvement and there can be a keratitis. So many a time the symptoms appear, a complex of symptoms may appear common to all the different tissues of the eye, but there will be one or two symptoms which will be much more flared up or prominent, which will guide us that, okay, it is not only conjunctiva, it is also the corneal involvement. So the difference between conjunctivitis and keratitis is that a patient with a keratitis or the inflammation of the cornea, whichever is the reason, whether it is viral, whether it is bacterial, whether it is traumatic, there will be intense photophobia. Another important thing which I learned from my experience is more superficial tissue involvement, more are the chances of reversibility, except in cases of malignancy. Like example, there is conjunctivitis. Okay, conjunctival involvement. Although conjunctiva is a superficial part of the eye, but if it has a malignancy, then the prognosis will also become poor. Or if there is a coloboma or of the eye, then it is a congenital disorder. So then in that position, the coloboma cannot be completely cured. Okay, or anything which is congenital cannot be completely cured, or the prognosis will be little less guarded. Okay, it will be little less guarded. That is what. So there has been efforts in classifying the disease, which may help to approach the cases homeopathically better into various categories, depending upon what is the tissue involvement, whether it is a lid, conjunctiva, cornea, lens is in a capsular bag, that is known as capsule, sclera is there, then there is episclera also, uveal tract, ciliary body, choroid, macula and retina. So these are the various tissues. Then according to etiology, which I have already explained, injury, inflammation, autoimmune, malignancy, congenital, senile. So these are various according to the causation of the disease. So now moving next, concept on which a homeopathic treatment can be provided to the patient is always based on three important things: to know what is the knowledge of the disease. We should know the disease knowledge, and in order to know the disease knowledge, we should know the anatomy very well. Then knowledge of pathophysiological changes, the inflammatory process and which stage of inflammation the person is, especially I am emphasizing more on inflammatory and pathophysiological changes, because the eye is a very, very sensitive organ, and if you don't act on time, there are chances that some changes can be irreversible. Like example, if there is inflammation of the iris and we don't aggressively treat it, the iris iris will become very frail, and it will become very sticky, and it will actually stick onto the lens, and then you lose the pupillary reflex, or there will be loss of accommodation. And this is mainly because the inflammation was not controlled in on time. That is why in modern medicine, if there is an iritis, the ophthalmic surgeon will say that put a eye drop which will keep your pupils dilated so that it doesn't get stuck onto the lens. Okay. So example, they will give you dilating drops. So knowledge of clinical examination and diagnostic techniques. While we are doing clinical examination, we often get modalities. This is what I have seen. When I am doing a clinical examination, or I am doing dressing of a patient with the eye involvement, we often get certain modalities like sensitive to touch, sensitive to light, or you know, better by dark, better by patching the eye, better by you know, worse by draft of air, better by covering the eye. So these modalities which I used to get. So let us focus on the anatomy. The basic anatomy, I think everybody knows. It's like, you know, the cornea, the anterior portion is the cornea. Okay, this is a layer of the cornea. Then there is an anterior chamber, a chamber which is extending from the posterior aspect of the cornea and the iris. So this is known as the anterior chamber. So basically, anterior chamber is filled with aqueous humor. Aqueous humor is produced in the ciliary body. This is a ciliary body. Then it comes just below the iris and it gets filled into the anterior chamber. The function of the aqueous humor is to maintain the integrity of the anterior chamber and provide nourishment to the cornea, because cornea is one organ which does not have vasculature. So it receives its nutrition from the aqueous humor and some vasculature which is there at the sclerocorneal junction, the junction which is between the cornea and the white portion. That circumferentially there are blood vessels. If you can see, there are circumferentially blood vessels at the edge of the cornea. So that's known as sclerocorneal junction. There are capillaries, and these capillaries supply the nourishment to the cornea. And the aqueous humor is another thing. Why am I saying is any injury to the cornea is very difficult to heal because it does not have a direct blood supply, first of all. Or if there is any kind of vascularization of the cornea which takes place, that will be more difficult to treat because cornea is supposedly physiologically, it needs to be transparent so that the entry of light happens from the environment, it falls onto the lens, and then it get refracted onto the retina. So this is the function of the cornea. So this is about cornea, anterior chamber, iris, you know, it is like a shutter of the camera. So whenever there is excess of light coming into the eye, especially in daylight, the shutter of the camera becomes narrowed, or it contracts, the pupil contracts. And if there is less of light, especially in dark, the pupils dilate. So this shuttering mechanism, also known as pupillary contraction and dilatation, and this is mainly in order to control the intensity of light coming into the eye. So there behind the iris, there is a lens which is in the lens capsular bag. There is a bag where the lens is intact, and it is held in position because of the suspensory ligament. Okay, so this is the thing. Then posterior extension, and the outermost coating is the sclera. Sclera is nothing but it's a fibrous tissue which gives integrity to the eyeball. And below the above the sclera, there is episclera, which is like a thin membrane. So episclera, sclera, below the sclera, there is choroid. Choroid is a layer which is basically richly embedded with what we say, vasculature. So it supplies vascularity to every structure which is below and above. And then there is retina. So retina is a neurosensitive sensory organ, which is basically rich in rods and cones. And the purpose of the retina is to carry the signal from the eye through the nerve bundle, that is known as optic nerve, which is seen here. and that goes and gets relayed into the brain. So that's known as an optic nerve. And it is, you know, as it is that it is in the occipital lobe of the brain, you have a visual cortex. And there the images are relayed and you can start interpreting, okay, this is a car, this is a camera, this is a tube light, this is a calendar. So all this interpretation happens at the higher level. So this is all about, in short, the anatomy. So I have already mentioned it's like a globe, which is composed of various various membranes. I have already spoken about the optic nerve. With the optic nerve, we also have central retinal artery and central retinal vein, which gives a nourishment to this particular structure, neurosensory structure. The posterior globe is filled with, the way anterior chamber is filled with aqueous humor, posterior chamber is filled with the vitreous. Vitreous is there, which is just like a jelly-like substance, which is also transparent so that the light can easily pass through it and fall onto the retinal layer. The centermost portion of the eye, is the fovea. The centermost portion is the fovea, which is supposedly the blind spot. And there is, if I am looking at someone and someone else is looking at me, the central vision is because of the macula. So macula is the centermost portion, which is rich in maximum number of rods and cones, and it is responsible for the central vision. So if there is any problem with the macula, the central portion with which we focus, if I am focusing at someone, I am seeing through, if I am looking at the camera, I am trying to see through my macula. If my macula is disturbed, I will always see a black spot in the center of my vision. So this is what happens. So the structure of the cornea. Now let us understand the corneal structure and then we will start discussing the case. Few of my experience I will share. The structure of the cornea is, the outermost portion of the cornea is epithelium. Second layer is Bowman's layer. Third is stroma, Desmond's layer, and last is the endothelium. So endothelium is the last, and through this endothelium, the nourishment is supplied to all the layers of the cornea, because the aqueous humor supplies the nutrition through the endothelium. And epithelium is supposedly the superficial most layer of the cornea. So anterior part of the membrane, which is transparent, cornea is always transparent, is cornea. It's like a watch glass, which is overlapped by the sclera all around the periphery. So it is like, you know, watch glass, which has been inverted, and on the periphery, it has been embedded by the sclera. So the important tip here is for all of us is, if the stroma layer of the cornea gets damaged because of either inflammation or injury, then the cornea will lose its transparency, and the corneal opacity develops if the stroma is involved. So why am I saying this is, we have certain documented cases in our literature where the corneal opacity has been treated by various drugs, you know. But when we are dealing with patient, we have to understand what is the depth of the injury or inflammation and which layer of the cornea has been involved. More permanent is the opacity, the chances of the stroma and the deeper layer involvement is. So if the injury passes beyond the stroma and it goes and reaches Desmond's or endothelium, then it will actually lead to corneal perforation, and the aqueous humor will leak out of the cornea into the exterior. So this is what we need to understand. The moment we find that patient has come to us with a flat cornea, that means there has been an injury which has extended beyond stroma, and now the cornea is perforated and all the aqueous has leaked out. So such patient should be sent for direct surgical approach because the corneal repair is required and the anterior chamber has to be again refilled with artificial solutions so that the integrity of the anterior chamber is maintained. So as I've already mentioned, cornea is transparent glass like a windscreen of our car. So when there is a windscreen of a car, if there is anything dirty, anything, any stain, we can't see anything. Okay. So the similarly, cornea has to be transparent so that the light source can enter into the eye. So there is no vascular supply. The cornea gets its nutrition, which I've already discussed, from a sclerocorneal junction and endothelium. So time and again, I'm just reflecting the anatomical photograph is so that we can brush up. So this is what I have already discussed with all the group members. So now example of this particular case, if you see, there is a opacity. If you can see this opacity, this white color opacity, I can draw the edges. This is an opacity which is developed, which is a permanent opacity, very dense opacity. Now here it is not in the pupillary area, so the person can still have almost a near normal vision. Okay, but if this opacity, instead of being at around 5 o'clock position, if it would have been in the center and over the pupillary area, then the visual loss would have happened. So the injury, inflammation, post-inflammation or inflammatory changes often lead to adherent scarring in the cornea and opacity formation because there is a fibrous tissue deposition. And these kind of an opacity may lead to a permanent kind of a damage to the cornea. These are the cases which are an ideal candidate for, you know, corneal transplant and all. So this is what about the cornea in short. So we have to understand concept of reversibility versus irreversibility, because we have to classify per se structurally irreversible disease. There are certain cases where we find, you know, okay, corneal opacity has become little less, but to begin with, we have to tell patient that we can give a medicines and do our best. We cannot give a false promise to the patient saying that your dense opacity will get all right, you know. So I had a initial year of my practice, I had got a case of a corneal foreign body injury. So patient presented with right eye pain, watering of the eye and foreign body sensation. So there is something called as fluorescent stain. So there are strips of fluorescent stain which are available. We put it into the eye. It's like a small strip. We have to put it into the eye in the lower fornices, or the lower palpable pocket of the eye, and just close the eye. So the entire cornea will get stained. Or entire cornea will pick up the dye, and it will be only prominent in area where there is corneal abrasion. So if you see this green spot is the area where there is a corneal abrasion, and this is a place where the injury is. Okay, this is the spot where there is injury, this green color. So that means patient was working on a welding he was doing some welding work, and suddenly one small particle went into the eye. Patient presented with right eye pain, watering and foreign body sensation, as if sand like sensation, as if something is there. So that is known as foreign body sensation. So there was an injury, corneal injury. And so now here we have to examine and we have to do a fluorescent staining. Many a time if you do a torchlight examination, you may miss this injury. So that's why fluorescent staining is very important. So what we have to do is you have to identify the foreign body. We have to remove the foreign body, because if you don't remove the foreign body and only give medicine, it is not going to help, because there is something called as causa occasionalis. So the cause of the disease or the maintaining factor is still in the eye. The inflammatory response will not settle down. So the inflammatory, you have to treat the inflammatory response after removing the foreign body. So inflammatory reactions are present and the symptoms like photophobia and pain. So removal of the foreign body, and then you can follow it up with the homeopathic treatment for secondary dynamic affection. So we classify it as a surgical disease with one-sided expression with secondary dynamic inflammatory affections. So this is my understanding of what I am treating. When I took the rubric of eye injuries from foreign body or eye injury incision or eye injury laceration, these are three rubrics which I was referring from the synthesis software. So the remedies which were coming up were the Acerum, Hypericum, Staphysagria, Aconite, Arnica, Silica. So these are the remedies. So I started reading these remedies. So Acerum is an inflammatory remedy. It has an inflammation of the eye, burning is there. Patient is very much better with cold air, worse by sunshine, light, and heavy blow of wind is not tolerable, but in general better by cold application and cold air. So this was there, and there are sharp pains, neuralgic pains there in this particular remedy. Then in Hypericum, sticking pains through the right eye, burning, stinging in the tarsal and sty of the left lower lid. This is what was given in Borix Materia Medica. When I read Borix Materia Medica, Staphysagria and Clark's Materia Medica, laceration of cornea with prolapse of iris means the injury of the cornea of an extent where it can go to deeper layer, perforate the cornea, and prolapse of the iris is there. And it is also useful, especially in cases where there is a cataract surgery and there has been injury to the cornea while doing cataract surgery. And there is syphilitic iritis with bursitic pain in eyeball, temple, and side of the face, aggravation in the evening, morning on using the light. So seeing this, I thought of when there is a cornea as a seat of disease, mainly mentioned in Staphysagria. So I gave Staphysagria 200 every 1 hourly, and patient was asymptomatically much better over a period of 10 to 12 hours. So here in this is a very basic case, which is for, understanding, removing the maintaining cause and then giving a homeopathic medicine, because in a modern medicine or ophthalmic doctor's protocol is that you remove the foreign body. Then after this, you have to give a anti-inflammatory, antibiotic and a low grade steroid. And if the photophobia is too much, then they give a dilating drops. So, and these are the four types of medicine which they give. So I feel instead of giving four types of this, that is anti-inflammatory, mild dilating drops, a mild steroid, and an antibiotic, why not give a Staphysagria and see what is the response. So here, if you can see, it was again stained, but the stain has not been taken up. The foreign body has been removed. Patient eye is quiet. The patient eye is quiet means there is no inflammatory response. Patient eye doesn't have any photophobia. And eventually this is denuding of the epithelium, which will heal. Denuding of epithelium happens when we are trying to remove the foreign body, which is embedded in the epithelial tissue. So we try to denude it and remove the foreign body. So this was one case which helped me to understand, okay, how do we proceed and how do we follow a basic concept and give some result in cases of corneal foreign body injuries, which are nowadays very common because the transportation is very high, the pollutants are very high, the number of jobs have been very, very high, and so many patients are exposed to such injuries. And especially if you can act on time, you can really save the eye, because I've seen patients who have got a foreign body, they have delayed the treatment, they keep on rubbing because of the irritation, and instead of one spot, the foreign body goes and scratches the entire cornea, because, and then the eye becomes really difficult and patient lands up with a chemosis of the conjunctiva and all these things. So this is what we can do. Then what I understood is the cornea is most sensitive part of the eye because it has got high sensory innervation. So trigeminal nerve is the nerve supply. So if patient presents with intense photophobia, then it has to be a corneal involvement and we have to do a detailed examination to find out, especially in cases of herpes zoster. When a patient comes with herpes zoster, there is lesion around the periorbital area and patient has got a lot of redness and we find that maybe conjunctivitis is there. No, the herpes virus has affected the nerve and because the trigeminal nerve has been involved, that's why patient has got severe photophobia. So that can be seen by you know, doing a slit lamp examination and finding that there are certain herpetic eruptions or herpetic lesions seen in the cornea. So there will be certain evidence. So we have to see that. So let us go towards the next case. This is a case of an ophthalmic emergency which comes to us. And this case has taught me a lot. So I felt that I should share with you. So this is a case of a corneal laceration with hypopyon, with iritis, with posterior sinicae, with pupillary capture, and with complicated cataract. So there was injury to the cornea. Then there was a hypopyon. Hypopyon is nothing, but it is a pus in the anterior chamber because once there is injury, the infection entered the anterior chamber. Then there was inflammation of the iris. Because the iris was involved, inflamed, it got stuck onto the lens, and that is known as, because the lens is posterior, that's why it is known as posterior sinicae. With pupillary capture, pupil, as I had already mentioned earlier, if there is an inflammation of the iris and it gets stuck onto the lens, the pupillary reflex is lost, that is known as pupillary capture. And because of so much of inflammation in the anterior chamber, the lens also got involved and it got opacified because of the inflammatory process. And that opacification is known as secondary complicated cataract. So it's a secondary complicated cataract. So this is a person, this is actual photograph of that patient's eye. This is what he came with. It was an acute, edematous, congested, swollen, watery eye with visual loss. He could not see anything. So it's a 45 years old fisherman who came to the casualty of our hospital with an alleged history of injury with the left to the left eye with an iron wire when he was while fishing. So there is iron wire which they use it for fishing, and that wire, you know, just rotated and hit his eye. And this incident had taken 10 to 13 days back, around 10 to 12 days back. The presenting symptom was left eye redness, lacrimation, swelling, pain, watering, and visual loss. After the injury, patient could not even open the eye. And so even we were trying to open it with the fingers, he was not able to open the eye. And the pain was stitching type of pain, as if something is poking. Very, very sensitive to light, very, very sensitive to cold air. And he was just keeping his hand over here or the handkerchief around, and he was better by warmth. So this was the symptom which was there on the presentation. This is the examination. This was just a naked eye examination. Both lid and edema, congestion, lacrimation, photophobia, PR and PL. When we say PR and PL, it is very important in a case where the patient is not able to see anything. And there is a lot of inflammatory process. So the PR stands for projection of ray, R-A-Y, and projection of light. So when we project a light, we take a torch and we project a light. Suppose this is my injured eye and I project a light. And as a doctor, I have to ask whether you can see the light. And he says, yes, I can see the light. Then we have to change the direction of the light from different angle, different quadrant. And you ask him whether you can identify from which quadrant the light is coming. So he will say it is coming from right upper quadrant, right lower quadrant, left upper, left lower. So then this gives us a clue that there is a life in the retina. Life in the retina, that means retina is still intact. There is no injury to the retina. There is no damage to the retina. Why am I saying this is because when you are seeing a congested eye, you cannot see anything. You cannot see anything beyond. The cornea will be hazy. There will be pus in the anterior chamber. There will be so much of photophobia. So when you try to do an ophthalmoscopic examination, it is next to impossible. So the only way we can come to know is either doing PR, PL, or you're doing a sonography of the retina, of the eyeball, where the retina can be seen. And you can come to know, okay, there is whether the retina is intact, because you treat this and ultimately if the vision does not come back, then the problem is with the retina. So before you start the treatment, we should know whether the retina is intact or it is not intact, because you can tell the patient that, you know, the chances of recovery, or the you can share the prognosis of the case. So this is the after we open the eye. So now from this, you can't see anything. I'm just trying to show you with the, see this particular thing in the lower quadrant is nothing but it's a pus in the anterior chamber. Crescentric thing which we are seeing, this white thing crescentric in the lower chamber is nothing but the pus in the anterior chamber. And this is in the center, the pupil, between the pupil is the lens which is completely opacified. It is a cataract. It is a cataract. So now, it is now the slit lamp examination. Now you see how beautiful is this all photo. In this case, we must have done more than 1,000 photographs, because this is a very interesting case. If you can see here, this cut at 8 o'clock, this is a corneal laceration. We have taken photo from all the angle by putting a camera on the slit lamp and just clicking it. If you see in the center, this iris is being stuck to the posterior lens, and this brown pigments which you are seeing is mainly because the iris pigments have got deposited on the lens, because when the iris becomes inflamed, it is so friable that it will go and start shedding pigments everywhere. So you'll see pigments which will get stuck onto the lens, or there will be pigment in the anterior chamber of the eye also. So now this is one of the beautiful photograph. Here you can see in the lower quadrant, there is a pus. You can see this iris is stuck posteriorly. These are iris pigment. Centrally, you can see there is a cataract. You cannot. So now imagine if you do fundoscopy, you cannot see anything. When you use an ophthalmoscope and try to see, you cannot see. That's why PRPL will give us a rough judgment or rough idea. And final confirmation can be by doing a B scan. B scan is a sonography of the eyeball, where you come to know whether retina is still intact or there is retinal detachment. We are worried about retinal detachment because the injury impact can be so much or so intense that the retina can also get detached. So here the iris is looking very, very muddy. Muddy. Muddy means congested iris. Posterior sinicae, because the iris is stuck onto the lens and the pupil is completely got deformed or irregular pupil. And this is what I was talking about, hypopyon, that is a pus in the anterior chamber. This is known as pus in the anterior chamber. So this patient comes after 10 to 12 days where all the full-blown picture has come up. And he has already taken treatment from the local primary healthcare center, where he was given antibiotics, he was given steroids, he was given topical eye drops and all. So he says that, you know, this is already, I am on treatment and now I am not getting better. What is the next step? So this is what I was trying to say. Iris has got stuck. So you see this photograph is one of the beautiful photograph. And we were struggling with a basic camera, but we could click the photo. So now, during the slit lamp examination, what we found was there is a circumcorneal congestion, photophobia, corneal laceration, hypopyon, pupils are not reacting to light, posterior sinicae, iris pigments, and complicated cataract. This was all the findings. So now, here the knowledge of the anatomy is very important, which will help us to understand the knowledge of the disease. I have already explained about the cornea. We will not go again. Cornea has to be transparent. It should not have any vasculature so that the ray of light can enter. and curvature of the cornea is very important because it helps us to focus on the objects which are close or far. So the if suppose there is the curvature of the cornea gets distorted, then automatically we go into astigmatism. So the curvature is very important. So injury in this case has abraded or disturbed the protective layer of the eye, disruption of the barrier, and that's why there was an infection. So patient had already gone to a ophthalmologist at PHC. He was given this antibiotic and he was given this ointment and this steroid eye drop. Predmed eye drop is a steroid. Tablet Visalon is also a steroid. And patient was already taking it for 10 to 12 days. So what we did first thing is after examination, we got to know that we should do a B scan or a sonography. There was no evidence of any retinal detachment, no evidence of vitreous hemorrhage. Because these are the two things which will help us. If these two are present, then the prognosis will reduce. And we also did tonometry. Tonometry is a method of measuring the eye pressure. So the right eye pressure was 13.6, which is below within the normal limit. And left eye was 14.2, which is this also is a normal. Because many a time what happens is because of the injury and inflammation, and these iris pigments can block the canal of Schlemm. Canal of Schlemm. So I'll just show you which are the canal of Schlemm. So this at the corner, at the angle of the cornea and the iris, there are canal of Schlemm. If the pigments are shed, it gets deposited on the lens. And if these pigments can go and block the canal of Schlemm through which the aqueous humor drains out. If the drainage is blocked, the aqueous humor will remain in the anterior chamber and it will elevate the pressure of the anterior chamber, that is known as rise in intraocular pressure. So intraocular pressure is very dangerous. So diagnosis I have already discussed with you. So here ophthalmologist would do at this stage, what is the line of treatment for an ophthalmologist is subconjunctival injection of an antibiotic. And second, they have to do is paracentesis. Paracentesis is nothing but aspiration of the pus, which is there in the anterior chamber, and wash the anterior chamber. So all the infective debris or inflammatory debris can be cleared off. And along with that, what they do is they put atropine in order to dilate the pupil. So pupil needs to be dilated so that less of the iris gets stuck to the lens. So this is what an ophthalmic surgeon has to offer. And vis-a-vis this, what homeopathy can offer. That was a big question mark because we were really scared with this case. Because the clinical understanding in this case is there was a trauma. Because of trauma, there was infection, suppuration, inflammation, and thereafter there was complication like iritis, cataract, and that's why the person has lost the vision. Now, I further classified this disease as it's a local surgical non-miasmatic disease to begin with secondary dynamic effect, miasmatic expressions, which was a secondary dynamic miasmatic expression. So initially it began with as a surgical, followed by a fully developed expression of the disease, which was seen in this particular case. So it is a structurally irreversible disease. When you say structurally irreversible, certain component inflammatory process can be reversed, but there is something called as cataract, which is a complicated cataract. We cannot be reversed back. We cannot target it as a means it to be cured. Our objective should be the reversal of the inflammation, control of the infection, and the visual restorement should come, and the inflammation should lessen. So this is what we were targeting. Then the caution, progressive hypopyon. If the hypopyon or the pus keeps on increasing, it is going to block the iris pigment can block. Similarly, the hypopyon can also block the canal of Schlemm or the angle of the anterior chamber, which will lead to glaucoma, that is a rise in the intraocular pressure, and the infection may spread to the posterior chamber. This is another problem. If the infection is not controlled, it can spread to the posterior chamber, and that is known as all the layers getting involved of the eye, that is known as panophthalmitis. So this is one condition which all the ophthalmologists is scared. You must have read in newspaper that, you know, the so-and-so patient was operated and suddenly lost the eyesight. So in such situation, panophthalmitis is a condition which develops if there is any infection. So we have to be very, very careful and really go step by step in this particular case. So this, what is the problem with the rise in intraocular pressure is this. If the intraocular pressure rises, then there will be a pressure on the optic nerve and the patient's optic nerve will get atrophied. Even if you treat, eye and inflammation and infection will settle down. But if the nerve is dead, the person's eyesight is gone. So that's why we have to be careful in all. Means everywhere there is a caution sign and we have to work in a guarded manner at all the steps. One hand, there is infection, inflammation, complication, chances of panophthalmitis, chances of optic atrophy. So the meaning, why am I discussing this with all the group member is, we have to prognosticate the case. We have to understand the planning and programming of the case. What if this particular thing does not improve? We should know where the complication can happen. And we should be knowing it where we have to stop. Because see, all the cases will improve. No doctor in this entire world can guarantee that everything he will treat or she will treat will give a 100% guaranteed result. So there are chances of failure. So we have to know where we can fail, which is a point where we have to stop. So this is what is known as optic atrophy. Optic atrophy is nothing but you can see there is a optic disc in the retina, and in the center of the disc you have a optic cup. Normally the size of the optic cup is 0.2 to 0.3. That means only it is of a size of 20 to 30% of the entire optic disc. If this optic cup keeps on widening or increasing in size, that means the nerve, optic nerves are dying, and that's why this cup is widening and patient is moving towards an optic atrophy. So this is what an ophthalmologist examines whenever a glaucoma patient goes to him. I think this we have already discussed. So now the strategy of treatment in this particular case is first the medical line of treatment. I am going to treat with homeopathic. That was my agenda. Corneal injury hai, infection is there, pus is there, all this thing is there. Aim is to treat the infection, to reduce the inflammatory sign, that is control iritis, and completely quieten the eye. All the inflammatory signs should disappear. That will be only possible if the infection as well as inflammation is gone. And second step, we have to understand when we should respectfully hand over the patient to our competent team of ophthalmic surgeons also. Second step is surgical treatment. Cataract is a sequelae to the inflammation. That means it's a complication of the inflammation in an eye which was injured. So cataract, which is a mature cataract and a complicated cataract, it is a hindrance to the normal vision. So even if you treat infection and inflammation, this hindrance needs to be removed so that patient can start seeing. So it requires surgical line of treatment, cataract extraction with iridectomy. This iris which is stuck to the lens needs to be trimmed and removed so that the lens can be extracted and to restore the normal vision. So this is an objective when I take the case. So homeopathic medical line of management, cause is injury, simple. Second, there is suppuration. This is what is been understood while we start taking the formulating the totality. Modifying factors which the patient said, the modalities. So we made an acute totality of their eye injury from eye inflammation, iris hypopyon with. There is an inflammation of iris and hypopyon. Eye pain, air cold aggravation. Eye pain, warm application amelioration. And eye pain, stitching. So these are the remedies which are coming. Hippar, silica, thuja, spigelia, aconite, sulfur, nitric acid. I repeat, hippar, silica, thuja, spigelia, aconite, sulfur, nitric acid. So these were the remedies which were coming on repertorization. So now we, because patient had already gone through 10, 12 days of treatment, we have some time that we can also take the constitutional history of the patient. So when we started taking constitutional history, we came to know that he's a fisherman, very silent person, non-interfering, doesn't retaliate much. Even if there is fight with the neighbor, wife has to intervene. He is completely quiet, and I mean, he is very silent and quiet, but there are no fears. It is not out of timidity. He doesn't interfere. He says that I don't like fighting. So basically, he is mild by nature. He is very, very hardworking person. Work is very important for him. And he continued to work in spite of this much of problem with his eye because of his tumor. So he is a mild individual, very industrious. So this was some reference which we took from Kent's Materia Medica repertory. He is a chilly person, and winter cracks heal, that was seen. And this was an acute presentation which we got, which I have already discussed with you. Here we made the totality as per Boninghausen's approach. Then this was the result, disease result. And overall, we found that he falls into a tubercular miasm because of the injury and immediate reaction to the injury in form of inflammation and suppuration, resulting into suppuration. So chronic, what we thought was silica. So now acute totality which we made, we got hippar, silica, thuja, spigelia, aconite, nitric acid. And in chronic constitutional also, we are getting silica. Now seeing the suppuration and seeing the inflammation, there was a dilemma in my mind when I was treating whether we should go with the acute phasic remedies, which other than silica, which was coming, or we should go with directly constitutional remedy silica, which is also there in the acute phase. This was the dilemma in my mind. Focusing on the pathology, I started differentiating the remedy. Hippar, silica, sulfur, spigelia, all the remedies, we started differentiating. Before the differentiation process, what we understand is about the disease phenomena. We got a reference. Disease as a dynamic phenomena in nature proceeds from the different phases, right from normalcy to diathesis to disease. And once the disease starts, it goes from prodrome functional to structural. So this is a concept of pathogenesis. Here there was a causation disease effect which progresses and evolves, and it keeps on changing. You know, as a disease progresses, the symptomatology may also change. So this was something interesting which we found, and I thought I should share with you. So we started differentiating between hippar and silica, because silica is covering constitutional. So my temptation was that why not we start with silica. So from Boger, Boninghausen, Clark, Kent, all these books, we started differentiating. Both the remedies, they have injury as a causation. Both the remedies, injuries can get converted into suppuration. And the only difference is the pathogenesis is little different in both the remedies, or the tissue involvement is little different in both the remedies. So in hippar, there is something called as quick suppuration and hypersensitivity, which has been mentioned in the Boger's synoptic key. In silica, suppurations are very, very slow. Many a times the suppuration may not even develop, and there are impending suppurations or incomplete abscesses and indurations which are seen in. So torpidity and slowness is what we found in silica. rapidity and quickness and violence is there in HIPAA self, and delayed stubborn and torpidity is there in silica. HIPAA self at the level of mind, they are hasty, violent, irritable, dissatisfied, touchy mentally and physically. So they are very hypersensitive HIPAA, and silica is very tolerant and endurance. Endurance is too much. Then in HIPAA, when we were trying to address the tissue involvement, cornea is a seat of disease in HIPAA as well as silica, both. HIPAA is also known for ulceration. Silica is more known for fibrotic processes of the cornea and opacification of the cornea. Whereas HIPAA self is more known for the ulceration of the cornea. Both have got common modalities, which is seen worse by cold and better by warm. When we read in detail, HIPAA self has more of corneal and anterior chamber involvement from Clark, and silica mentions that it has affinity for cornea as far as opacification and cicatrices or fibrosis is concerned, whereas it has got suppurative tendency for the lacrimal duct and the lacrimal apparatus. So there are more chances of patients in silica to land up with decryocystitis and lacrimal fistulae. So that was mentioned in the silica. When we understand through miasmatic understanding, HIPAA self originates from tubercular miasm and can get into syphilitic dimension. Silica originates from psychotic miasm and can advance into tubercular dimension. So miasmatic study can be done through the expressions of the disease while it progresses from its origin till the end. So reference from the ICR volume 3 or volume C. Whereas Spigelia, when we consider, it has affinity for nerves, and inflammatory pathologies are more seen in Spigelia, like iritis, which is there, or autoimmune phenomena, which are there, and a patient of rheumatoid arthritis developing iritis, or SSA, seronegative, developing iritis, or a case of SLE or scleroderma going into iritis. They don't manifest suppurative inflammations. They are very acute manifestations are seen in Spigelia, and basically it involves iris and the sclera as the seat of disease. So it is a remedy for scleritis and iritis, and pains are of neuralgic type, which are deep seated in the orbit or the sockets. And this was what about Spigelia. Sulfur is also a good remedy for inflammation, but suppuration is quite less. Predominant tendency is for the superficial structure of the eye, and allergic disorders are very common, like blepharitis, or it is allergic conjunctivitis, and the tissue involvement is eyelid, eyelashes, and conjunctiva. And here the patient is better by cold, and burning sensation is predominant. So now the option is again between HIPAA and silica, and considering this, and considering the relation between HIPAA and silica, both are related to each other. And so we understood the concept of complementary remedy also. So complementary action is related to the right timing of the administration of the remedy. So it means if a case requires a silica and you give HIPAA, or if it requires HIPAA and you give silica, and then you try to follow up with other remedy because it has got a complementary relation, the remedy may not work. Same remedy, if given out of the phase, becomes an antidote or ineffective. So you may not get that effective result. So like pulsatilla should be followed by silica or that kind of a thing. Or the cycle which we know, calcarea, lyco, and sulfur cycle we know. So this has been observed very often when we are understanding the complementary relationship. So in our case, we selected HIPAA self. The reason for selection was the causation, the speed at which the patient had developed the inflammation and infectivity. And in spite of all the antibiotics, steroids and all, patient was not responding. and it was a rapid pace disease, and predominantly the cornea has a seat of location, and the type of disease, it the suppuration at the level of cornea, we thought, let us give Hipasulf. So we started this Hipasulf as an acute phasic remedy. Still we believe that patient is silica as a constitutional, but we thought that we'll give Hipar. We started from the May till June, almost you can say almost in 2 months we were giving this medicine. Initially we started in 200 potency, and eventually we converted into 1 mg, and that was 5 pills every 4 hourly we started. And the follow-up which we saw was pain, swelling, lacrimation, redness, pus, photophobia, everything was much better. Cataract and posterior sinicae, being the sequelae of infection and inflammation, was the same, but the infection and inflammation had settled down and hypopyon had disappeared. So this is the post-treatment photograph. If you can see, the hypopyon has disappeared. It was in this quadrant, which has disappeared. Then the inflammatory process has settled down. This was another photograph. As I mentioned, this is a sequelae of the or the end result of the disease product, which we needs to be removed. That's a hindrance to the normal vision, but the infection and inflammation has settled down without any antibiotic, without any intravenous or subconjunctival antibiotics or any kind of anterior chamber wash or a paracentesis. Nothing was done, only homeopathic medicines were given. So this was an eye before the treatment, and this is an eye after the infection and inflammation had settled down. So our first step is achieved. Now the beauty of this case is, when we were handling this two months, we were giving this medicine every time we were treating it, and there was a supervision of an ophthalmologist also, because we wanted it to be very, very, very clear and transparent, because nothing is beyond, no system of medicine is beyond a patient. So that is my understanding, and I was very clear. In any point, if the patient is not improving, we will not take a risk, because eyesight is very important. So this was what we did. And seeing this enthusiasm, our ophthalmologist said that you treat the patient till the last trace of infection is removed, because I want to take this patient in the operation theater and remove the cataract without giving any pre-operative antibiotics. So let's, if the homeopathy has helped him so much, let us completely quieten the eye with the help of homeopathic line of treatment. And I don't want to intervene. I will give only the anesthesia and operate. I will give a peribulbar block and operate. And post-operative, whatever antibiotic is required, I will give. But pre-operative, I will not give any antibiotics. So this was what we had given. We had quietened the eye with Hipasulf. But the worry is that patient should not have any flare-up. So chronic constitutional remedies are deep-acting remedies or drugs which sustain effects at both my mental and functional and structural level. They represent a logical extension of action to the chronic phase, and it leads to conclusion of the case. So this one reference which we got, see, I try to put in some references, is because I always feel that whatever is written in the literature needs to be practically correlated. I know the platform is of a very high repute, but still I am trying to correlate whatever I have learned in the literature, and I try to correlate so that I myself remember it for future patient management. So then, followed by Hipasulf, we use silica in 30 potency, and we gave it weekly one dose for continuous 5 weeks. So 2 months of Hipasulf, and then 5 weeks of silica. Okay, every week one dose. So totally 3.5 months of treatment. And we were very sure that now there is no evidence of any infection and inflammation, because why am I saying if there is any traces of infection and inflammation and such a case is operated, there is a chance that patient can go into an infection of the posterior segment of the eye and panophthalmitis, and the patient can completely lose the eye because there will be shrinking of the eye that is known as thysis bulbi. Thysis bulbi means there is autodigestion of the entire eye structure. You must have seen, we come across patients whose eye is completely embedded into the socket, or it got absorbed, that is known as thysis bulbi. So that's why we took 3.5 months. Before that, we didn't touch the eye. Neither surgeon was in a hurry to do that. So then second step of surgical treatment was done to remove the cataract and restore the vision. Patient eye was quiet after homeopathic line of treatment. And ophthalmologist planned for the left eye cataract extraction with PCIOL insertion. PC means posterior capsular intraocular lens insertion. And this is how the operation was done. The lens, whatever was white, was removed, and it was replaced by an artificial posterior capsular intraocular lens. It was in position. And some amount of iridectomy was done, because if the iris is not removed or it is not cut, iridectomy means we are just cutting the iris. So that is to done so that we can free the lens. How, if it is not free, how can we remove the lens and how can we insert the lens? So that was what was done. And this was a photograph after the post operation. This patient's photograph after the operation. So this patient was completely better with the homeopathic line of treatment, and later on handed over respectfully to the ophthalmic surgeon for the operation of the sequelae, and the patient's eye, the vision of the patient was normal. After the lens was placed, his vision was 6x6. 6x6 is the best vision which we can give to any patient. There was no signs of infection and inflammation, even the post-operative. So now, I don't know how much time is.
Yes.
So we have covered this many case. I mean, there are many more cases. So if audience allow, I can discuss few more cases.
I think, doctor, we can have another session. Are you ready to?
Yeah.
Yes, definitely we want another session. So I think we can discuss the further cases in another.
Yeah. Yes, sir.